Dear graduates, dear newcomers, dear parents, friends, and supporters, dear staff members, welcome to one of the highlights of our law school, the graduation and welcome ceremony of our Master of Law and Business. My name is Katharina Bulewölki. I'm president of this wonderful institution. Dear class 2023, dear graduates, you have successfully completed our international and interdisciplinary master program. Both dimensions are key elements of this law school's profile in teaching and research. Today, we bid farewell to you, a group of individuals who have mastered the art of law and business. Through countless late-night study sessions, caffeine-fueled brainstorming, and the occasional existential crisis of a footnotes, you have formed bonds as unbreakable as a page of terms and conditions. As you venture into the world of billable hours and corporate jargon, may your arguments and, of course, your sense of humor be as airtight as your presentations. So here's to you, master of balance sheets, Excel sheets, statutes, terms, and precedents. May your days be filled with more victories than appeals, and may your careers be the ones you dream of. Farewell, dear graduates, but please stay in touch with us, because from the moment you entered our institution, you became part of the Bucerius Law School family. And as you know, family ties are binding. Dear class of 2024, welcome to the exhilarating master program. We are thrilled to have you on this adventure of knowledge, deadlines, and perhaps the occasional existential crisis over PowerPoints or computers which do not work. Now you may be asking yourself, why did I sign up for this? Fear not. Just remember that behind every legal statutes and balance sheet, there is a story awaiting to be unraveled. And yes, you will be reading more pages than you ever thought of possible. But think of it as training for your future negotiation skills. After all, persuading yourself that just one more chapter won't hurt is an art in itself. Welcome to the world of law and business, where words have power and numbers tell stories. You have chosen our master's degree to enhance your academic qualifications. Ask our graduates about their experiences and views and take advantage of all the opportunities that this law school, this city, and this country have to offer. Become part of our community, where courage, responsibility, and excellence are our core values. We look forward to watching you grow, both as scholars and as experts in deciphering the fine print. After all, it's not just a contract, it's a new chapter in your journey. Cheers to our new class. Let's make this academic festival one to remember. To this side of the auditorium, I offer my warmest congratulations. And to this side of the auditorium, my warmest welcome. We should all be happy and proud, and indeed, we are happy and proud. And it is my pleasure to give the floor to Professor Christina Günther. Thank you very much.
Dear President Katharina Bulewölki, dear Founding Dean Professor Larson, dear MLB Dean Professor Bisping, and of course the team, dear friends and supporters of the MLB program, and of course dear graduates, congratulations to your well-deserved degrees. I'm also sending the warmest regards from the entire WHU community and our leadership team. We are very happy that you joined the MLB program a year ago and take on the adventure of a truly interdisciplinary master program. This was certainly challenging, but also contained one or the other highlight, I'm sure. One of my personal highlights from an academic perspective was your visit at the WHU campus in Düsseldorf. In our session with our MBA students, it became very obvious that you were very capable of combining the business and the law perspective. And I'm sure your program director, law, Professor Jungmann, would agree on that. Dear students of the new batch, a very, very warm welcome also from the WHU community. We are very much looking forward to hosting also you in Düsseldorf in May next year. I would also like to take the opportunity to thank you, Katharina, for fostering this long-lasting partnership between Bucerius Law School and the WHU Otto Weisheim School of Management. Your personal engagement helped revoke the partnership and facilitated our joint mission to educate future leaders with open minds, courage, and commitment. Dear graduates, this is your day and an important step in your life. Your learning and personal growth will certainly not end today, as there are many grand challenges ahead of you. But today, you reached a very important milestone. Enjoy this wonderful day and celebrate your achievement with your classmates, friends, and of course, with your families and your beloved ones. We are very proud and grateful that we were part of your journey and wish you all the best for what the future holds for you. Thank you.
Dear graduates, dear newcomers, dear Katharina Bühle-Wölki, dear Dean Christoph Bisping, Christina Günther, dear Cliff, and dear professors. Like every year, I spent a week at Stanford Business School earlier this year. Best professors are brought together for a week to discuss current development and trends in business and economy with a circle of global entrepreneurs. In this week, we are always confronted with merciless professors. So you'd better be carefully prepared. Just one example what can happen if you are not prepared and how you can end up in classroom. I remember Professor Francis Frey once with a classmate, after having listened patiently and carefully to my classmate who tried to answer Professor Frey's question, she shouted in the classroom, "That's a great answer, but to a different question." Of course, at Stanford we have dealt a lot with large language models like ChatGPT and questions like what impact will AI have on society, on the labor market. But as an exciting side issue, we also dealt this year with the topic, why has such a globally unique digital hub been able to develop in Silicon Valley? And why not in Texas, in Canada, in Europe, in Japan, or in China? Fascinating if you dig deeper. Of course, as always, it's a mixture of different factors who made Silicon Valley to what it is nowadays. I only mentioned two. The first, at the starting point, it was the semiconductor industry. While vacuum tubes were still used until the mid of the 40s to translate meaning in a binary number system, it was a physicist and Nobel Prize winner William Shockley who realized that chemical elements can also translate this binary system or the ones and zeros. Shockley left Bell Labs and settled with his mother in what is now Mountain View. And there, later, other semiconductor companies were established. The second factor is more important today. The semiconductor industry was joined by those who worked with this raw material. Many were graduates from Stanford. programmers, creative people, nerds, people who like to experiment with the idea of advancing knowledge and meaning in a binary code to such an extent that one day it might be able to think for itself. It was always an environment of Vietnam War opponents, technology, faith, and hopes, utopians who could think completely free. An environment that could flourish and thrive in Florida in the late 60s. LSD may also have played a role at that time. Stuart Brand was the first visionary who attracted these talented people to this melting pot. He organized the first hackers conference in Palo Alto at the end of the 60s. Participants were Bill Gates, Steve Jobs, Steve Wozniak, and many other pioneers who out of this ecosystem later founded Apple, Microsoft, Google, Facebook, and many others. It was the journalist Don Hoeffler who coined the term Silicon Valley in 1971 in a series of articles. At the heart of Stuart Brand's initiative was a catalog he published between 1968 and 71, the Whole Earth catalog. It was a catalog that compiled descriptions and graphics of the craziest ideas at that time surrounding technological innovations, like the first prototypes of automated vacuum cleaners. It was almost science fiction. A compendium of the knowledge of its time, a kind of Google 30 years before Google was founded. People thinking without limits, following their ideas, even if they apparently do not make sense, not letting himself be swayed in this passion, and working in a team of passionate, convicted doers. That's what Silicon Valley made what it is. On the back cover of the Whole Earth catalog, the last issue, Stuart Brand had published the guiding motto of his life and the life of all these in the hackathon. Stay hungry, stay foolish. Steve Jobs took up this motto when he recalled this story of Stuart Brand at a commencement speech in Stanford in May 2005. And Jobs explained how much he has learned in this environment of addicted, passionate people who followed unconditionally their convictions and passions, and this helped him and Steve Wozniak founding Apple. I congratulate, in the name of the Hans Weiser Stiftung, you, the graduates, and of this class, and what I would like to encourage you in the name of all of the Hans Weiser Stiftung and my colleague Julia Runte, she might be here, never stop following your passions and your convictions. Stay hungry and stay foolish. Congrats.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm very grateful for our own president and for Professor Günther from the WHU and also for Dr. Baumann from the Hans Weiser Stiftung, one of our most important sponsors, for their words of welcome. I'm here now to introduce our main speaker for tonight, Sonja Radovich-Paul, who is an alumna of our program. And it is a tradition of the MLB graduation ceremony that an alumnus or alumna talks to you. And they always give the main speech of the night in recognition of their continuing connection, of their family ties to our MLB family. Tonight's speaker, Sonja, graduated in 2018, having originally trained and then practiced law in her native Serbia. After the MLB program, she turned first to a stint at AXP in Berlin and then set up her own consultancy firm, Cody Impact GmbH. She's also an advisor and mentor at Femtech Lab, where she is particularly engaged in supporting female entrepreneurs. She is a prime example of how the experience of the MLB program can change lives. She's changed not only her career path, from a more traditional career in the law to one in a business environment, but she's also met while in Hamburg her husband and now lives in Berlin. I welcome to the stage Sonja Radovic-Paul.
Oh. That's a great introduction. Thank you, Professor Bisping. So, dear Professor Bisping, members of Bucerius Law School, proud families and friends, new class, and above all, my fellow alumni as of tonight, first of all, I wanted to say thank you for having me here and trusting me with this honor. Delivering a commencement speech is a great responsibility. However, reflecting on the ceremony I heard sitting where you are 6 years ago helped me greatly in preparing this address. It turned out I couldn't remember a single word any of the speakers said that night. This liberating discovery enables me to proceed without any fear that I might accidentally influence you to abandon your promising careers in business or law for the delights of jumping into building your own companies one day. Actually, I racked my mind about what I'm supposed to say to you tonight. And after many, many back and forths, I decided to share a personal story of someone who sat exactly there 6 years ago and then two short semesters later decided to step way outside of any comfort zone imaginable at that point. The interdisciplinary learning of the MLB program led me to completely change my trajectory. And I stand before you today as a living testament to its benefits. Seeing so many new faces here tonight makes me hopeful that my words will resonate to some of you and that you will consider giving yourself a chance to do exactly what I did in the course of the years following my MLB degree. Dive into something new and unfamiliar, however that may look for you. I distinctly recall my expectations upon arriving at Bucerius Law School. I would be on a holiday. I was eager to escape long hours at a law firm, and absolutely, without any doubt in my mind, I would go back to the same life that I had before Bucerius and continue exactly the same journey I was in for. My mind was set, and I took the year at Bucerius with somewhat low expectations, to be honest. Sorry, Professor Larsen, this was due to no fault of your own. However, what was the direct fault of Professor Larsen and many people sitting here in this auditorium was a life-changing year that continues to astonish me to this day. As Professor Bisping mentioned, I'm currently building and growing my own company. It's a software company, actually, with a great team and some excellent investors by my side. Not so long ago, such a scenario would have exceeded the bounds of my wildest imagination. And the spiral of this disruptive change actually started exactly here on these grounds. While I listened to the first lecture by Professor Peter Witt. Now, I can't remember his words exactly, so please apologize for this potentially bad paraphrasing. But I remember him candidly explaining that two times before he has tried to build a company and then that didn't really work out. So the sheer honesty of what I thought was a failure, even two failures, took me by surprise and made me rethink one of my biggest fears to this date. As of that moment, I did two things. First of all, I took every single lecture Professor Witt had to offer, obviously. So if he ever hears this speech, please say thank you for all of us, or on behalf of all of us, whose mind he so openly challenged. And secondly, I decided to try something new for myself, even if I fail. By the time we left Bucerius, my mind was set on starting a business. I had no idea what, with whom, how, and how is this going to turn out, but these were mere details. After all, I attended all of the venture classes, and at that point, I was already able to sum in Excel, so I figured, how hard can this be? standing here today, 2 years into managing my own company that I started in the midst of an economic crisis, I can safely say I may have overstepped some of my own assumptions. The difference, I knew then nothing, probably, and to this day I know very, very little. But the difference between then and now is that I have failed so many times in so few years, and I'm still alive and standing here. This knowledge has set me free to do so much more, and it is what makes me happy about what I do and where I am every single day. Now that I told you how many times I failed, maybe it's time to move to a more inspirational part of the speech. But I'm going to get there in a minute. I wanted to reflect on one thing first. As you're sitting here today, uncertain about in just about anything, from your job-seeking visas, leaving your countries, missing your families, weather in Hamburg, I won't assume that my experiences mirror yours. Each of us carries a unique set of challenges, and our responses to these challenges vary greatly. Yet one fact remains universally true. Our challenges evolve, and we only stand to win if we evolve with them. For example, I love so many things about managing my own company. From the fact that I choose who I work with, to the fact that I can increase my own salary. Mind you, it goes both ways, so I get to decrease it way more frequently. But I was going for a completely different challenge. Insecurity. According to our business plan that I made in Excel, I am only certain to have a job for another 8 to 10 months. Now, as much as I throw it in as a fun fact today, and it is a fun fact, it's something since 6 years ago I would have dreaded with everything that I had. So much so, I wouldn't have even started this journey altogether. What helped me get here are people who shared their energy, knowledge, and counsel along the way, who cheered for me from wherever they are, who invited me to speak to you today in acknowledgement that I did something good. In these past few years, every time we lost a lead, our software malfunctioned, or an investor passed on us, I needed not a rock, but a mountain of support. And I found it in my family, my exceptional co-founders, my husband, but also some of my best sounding boards were my Bucerius classmates. And this leads me to my point. You are currently surrounded by the strongest support system you will find in your new home country if you decide to stay here. While the person beside you might hold some Reeperbahn material that should never resurface, it's probable that they're also your best friend and your anchor in the journey ahead. We are all up for many more rejections, setbacks, and tests to our character as the time goes by. So here is my ask. Once you leave this beautiful place, don't forget each other. Reach out to your colleagues, alumni, share your pains, your plans, brainstorm your ideas, ask for support, and please, please give support. Refrain from actively seeking out worst-case scenarios. Instead, embrace the beauty that accompanies stepping beside your comfort zones. After all, you are already in a whole new country, and at some point you will start giving up on the idea that you will learn German past the A2. You have the knowledge, just being here is a sufficient proof of that, but I do encourage you to go beyond that. Give your energy to create something new, and it will come back manifold. In the spirit of that, I will leave you with a promise and a pledge of my own time for anyone who asks for it. If I got one person interested in jumping off board, please reach out for any type of advice and even more encouragement. We are privileged to have such diversity of mindsets here and tasked to build it into a strong bastion for generations to come. Finally, class of 2024, I can truthfully say I envy you. You are up for one whirlwind of a year, and I will see you in Berlin. And class of 2023, congratulations. You have achieved something remarkable. So please celebrate your wins today, as they are really not small. Thank you all. It was really a pleasure speaking to you today.
All right, good evening, and I think we will now proceed to the most important event of this evening, the awarding of your degrees, and I think you know what to do. I'm reading out the names, and hopefully you won't remember me for mispronouncing your names and then forget the wonderful words which you should remember Sonia just addressed to you. So that's to remember my little mispronunciations, please excuse them. All right, okay, are we ready to go? Everyone's in place. And we start with Jocelyn Apsha from the United States of America. No. We keep it easy today. Okay. All right. Kemal Akan from Turkey. Roman Antony from Ukraine. Cynthia Belen Ayala Riveros from Paraguay. Protiti Basu from India. Right, the next row. Vivekanath Bhadwaj from India. Luciana Böhme Mercado from Bolivia. Qingcheng Chai from China. Estefania Cajo from Peru. Maria Valeria Casal Navarro from Paraguay. Vineeta Desai from India and Germany. Serjan Dragicevic from Serbia. Luis Hector Duron Aguilera from Mexico. Tanya Vanessa Eslava Suarez from Colombia. Amrit Greval from India. Yeah. Shubham Joshi from India. Yishin Ka from Taiwan. Furkan Kayim from Turkey. Viktor Kolobara from Bosnia and Herzegovina. Natalia Vasiliki Kontogiani from Greece. Ander Lozano Zurita from Mexico. Christian Nyvang Lund from Denmark. Adriana Martiniv from Ukraine. Bianca Mussolino from Brazil. Ah. Leonid Nolasco from the Philippines. Tamari Ortuidze from Georgia. Lishane Komal Proak from Mauritius. Sophia Rosenhöfer from Germany. Silvan Zen from Germany. Antoine Swanoff, okay, from Canada. Maria Stolbova from Ukraine. Laura Streubel from Colombia. Merve Tüzmen from Turkey. Waiting, Orhun Uhur from Turkey. Yefenia Voronyuk from Ukraine. Javiera Yanez from Chile. Gizem Yildiz from Turkey. And with only the master thesis to go, still waiting, but soon to come, not quite finished, but still here, Yael Ochoa from the United States. And not with us, I don't know if he's online, Vitaly Kozovich from Ukraine, I think in the United States at the moment. Congratulations.
Okay, the main act is done. Fantastic. Congratulations, everybody. I've got a few people to welcome, first of all. I don't think I introduced myself earlier. I'm Christopher Bisping. I'm the dean of the MLB program, and it's my honor now to speak to all of you. But in particular, I'd like to welcome our president, dear Katharina. I'd like to welcome our deputy CEO, dear Benedict. I'd like to welcome our program directors, Professor Jungmann and Professor Günther from WHU. I'd like to welcome our founding dean, without whom we wouldn't be here, dear Cliff. I'd like to welcome all the friends and supporters of the MLB program, and in particular Dr. Baumanns, for one of our most important sponsors, Hans Weiser Stiftung. I'd like to welcome the law school faculty and all other staff from the law school, and friends and family, everybody here. Now, this is the end of a very special part of your life, for many of you, and the beginning of a very special part of your life for others. Some are able to look back, to reflect, and to already reap the first fruit of your very hard labor in the form of receiving your graduation certificates, which you've just done. Others are looking forward to embarking on this journey and will be returning here next year. 2 years ago, dear Cliff, my predecessor, you mentioned on this occasion the two liminal points, the alpha and the omega, as part of your address to the group. I focused last year on, and I know nobody remembers, but I focused on what comes in between the metamorphosis that you went through in, or will be going through in the course of your degree. Today, I would like to look at our ethos, what we are all about, why we are here. And this topic came to me when I was on holiday in Spain recently with my family. And we visited a very small museum, which had a bit of a hodgepodge of exhibitions. Some focused on the house itself, and others were on particular themes. And in one of the temporary exhibitions, from an art collective called Caldore Cultivo, one particular piece of art stuck to my mind, and that was a bit of writing in neon, and the writing read, Fiat Ars et Pereat Mundus. Mercifully, my son is a budding classicist, so together I scraped down my last little few bits of Latin, and he helped me along, and we figured out that means, let there be art, even though the world perish. And I ponder this. I found it quite an interesting statement. And instantly it struck me, that's not what we are about. We would do something entirely different. We would not say, la pour la, art for the sake of art, but we would look at art or at any of the disciplines that we touch upon here, most notably the law and business studies, as a means to an end. We are not here just to do law or just to do business, but we are here for a purpose. And this statement, fiat ars, pereat mundus, reminded me of the sinking of the Titanic, when the musicians kept playing while the ship was sinking. So let us make art, even though the world around us perish. So the slogan had captured my interest, and when the locals in Spain started their fiesta, I turned to Google and looked it up and thought, where does it come from, what does it mean? And I found out that it is from a German philosopher, Walter Benjamin, who used it to describe the fascist usurpation of art as a means to achieve that movement's ends. An example might be the rhetoric of the total war that fascist leaders employ to whip the masses into a frenzy, supported by particular stories, music, and imagery that glorified and praised that lethal endeavor. The artistic devices employed here is the ars, or art, that is produced accompanying the end of the world, the end of civilization. It thus transpired to me then that my initial interpretation, it's only about art for the sake of art, was completely wrong, and that in fact it was art being employed as a means to an end, although be it ultimately a destructive end. At Bucerius Law School, in the Master of Law and Business program, we also seek to employ the disciplines that we are touching on to an end, or to several ends. We use the arts that we know something about, law and business, to achieve an end, to achieve social improvement, to achieve greater justice, to achieve better communication between business people and lawyers, etc. The social improvement that we are trying to achieve is in particular emphasized in one of the greatest gifts that Cliff Larson has left us, and that is the Studium Generale, which includes an element of a social project. Now, some of you might have thought that's an unnecessary hurdle in the way to graduating, but many of you afterwards have found that it was a very worthwhile endeavor. Medicine has to be bitter to be effective. As it happens then, when one searches the internet a little bit further, I was informed that the phrase fiat ars periat mundus is actually a play on a much older statement, fiat justitia et periat mundus. Let justice be done, although the world perish. That was in fact the motto of the Holy Roman Emperor Ferdinand I. He was emperor from 1556 to 1564, and it signifies as a maxim that justice has to be done whatever the cost. The law has to be applied irrespective of the consequences. That was later picked up by the German philosopher Immanuel Kant when he promulgated his categorical imperative. You have to follow a command absolutely irrespective of what the outcome is. And Kant actually rephrased it in the English translation at, let justice reign even if all the rascals in the world should perish from it. The price is a very high one, though. The simple command, thou shalt not lie, is taken in the absolute here. And it means that we must even not tell a white lie, a little lie that might shield somebody from a very hurtful truth and which does not necessarily to be revealed. As a motto for Ferdinand I, the Holy Roman Emperor, it is an utterly wrong one because he was heavily involved in the Peace of Augsburg, which allowed Catholics and Protestants to live together in the Holy Roman Empire, the mother of all compromises. So the opposite of a categorical imperative. Now, at the same time as Immanuel Kant picked up on the statement, over on the British Isles, a completely different movement took hold, and that is utilitarianism. And utilitarianism does not look for an absolute command, it looks for the greatest utility for the greatest number of people. In the last century, Ludwig von Mises wrote in his treatise Human Action, and I quote, the utilitarian economist does not say fiat justitia periat mundus, he says fiat justitia ne periat mundus. So in English, let justice be done lest the world perish. Or to rephrase, let justice be done so that the world won't perish. This statement sounds much more in line with our own ethos here at Bucerius Law School in the interdisciplinary, international and practice-oriented Master of Law and Business program. We strive for solutions that build the world rather than destroy it. We want to help communities to better communicate with each other. We are aware of our responsibilities towards society. As lawyers, we know that hard cases make good law only if we bear in mind the consequences for future cases. And as managers, we know that a selfish short-sightedness is very futile if it does not increase overall utility. Judging by the enthusiasm most of you have shown for the social project, at the end, the willingness with which you have met and embraced other cultures and disciplines, and the sense of fairness and justice that as a cohort you have brought to your studies, I know that this Bucerius ethos is strong with you. On our campus here, this ethos is embodied in that little German word Mut, courage. The courage to do the right thing, to take the path less trodden, to question received wisdoms, to enter new territories. Both managers and lawyers alike have to be aware of the consequences of their actions. They have to have principles, in law we call them rules, not just formal ones, but also moral ones. But they also have to be brave enough to break them when needed. A well-designed rule will allow for some flexibility. It will provide an escape clause for the unforeseen and unusual case. Self-imposed managerial principles must also be revisited when their application would lead to undesirable outcomes. You have touched on those questions when you studied corporate governance or corporate social responsibility, or indeed when you engaged with your social activities. Now, as I was on holiday, I had time to ponder the meaning of the little phrase I had picked up, fiat ars et periat mundus. And I delved a little bit into the background. Now the holiday's over and we are back to reality. And so I can say I was not satisfied by that motto with its call for absolute observance of certain principles, in particular in its original form, fiat justitia et periat mundus. I was much happier with the fiat justitia ne periat mundus variant. So in my holiday, I was on a little learning journey. And that reminded me of the journey that you have been on in this past year and the journey that you are about to embark on. The journey, however, never ends. And the completion of this program is merely the driver's license that you are given to now continue this journey on your own. But you won't be on your own. You won't be alone. It's not a solitary journey because, as we've already heard, we are a family and various family members offer us help. Over the last weekend, we have seen this family in action at a big family reunion. We saw it as a fantastic network. We were welcomed, we welcomed on campus alumni from 17 cohorts, yours included. And we went here on campus. We were invited to Professor Larsen's garden. We went to see the Elbphilharmonie, the Bucerius Kunstforum, and rekindled some old connections and made new friendship. On this note now, it is time for me to come to a close. But as always, I must not let you go out in the world without firstly restating the motto. And our motto here should not be fiat ars periat mundus. I think our motto should be facite justitia et negotii ne periat mundus. Do justice and business lest the world perish. I had to Google that. And as always, I must also not let you go without giving you my blessing on the way. So go forth into the world with compassion and justice in your heart. Give voice to the silent. Give strength to the weak. See one another. Hear one another, care for one another, and love one another. It's all that easy, and it is all that hard. Thank you very much. that I'm not a man to follow absolute imperatives. You can see now, I've just promised you I was coming to a close, and I continue. There you are. But now I'm no longer here as a speaker, but as a moderator, and I've got a very joyful task ahead of me, and that is to award a few prizes. Every year, the best teachers in our program in the category Law and Business are chosen by the students. And it's a choice that you don't make knowing that you make a choice. It is the outcome of the module evaluations. Now, this year we've got one winner business, one winner law, and they are both repeat offenders, if you so want, or repeat fantastic performers. The best rated business course was Logistics and Supply Chain Management by Professor Stefan Wagner from the ETH Zurich. His certificate is in the post, as he can't be with us today. Just very briefly, amongst the many positive statements, I picked up the following one. Somebody commented and said, amazing professor and very practically oriented class, really enjoyed the dynamics of the class. The Best Teacher Award Law goes to another serial recipient, and another Stefan, I don't know whether that plays a role, for his classes in international commercial arbitration, Professor Stefan Kröll.
Just to be very brief, it was a pleasure teaching you, and thank you very much. You heard so much from me.
Thank you, Stefan. Just one brief comment I wanted, or two I wanted to read out. One person was, he made us reason and think in every question asked. And I thought that for myself and everybody else teaching, that's what we should all do, shouldn't we? Another quote, which is just, the professor. He lives up to his hype. The experience is reflected in his lectures. Absolutely loved his course. Before we turn to awards to students, I wanted to take briefly the opportunity to say a few thank yous myself. Firstly, dear Katharina, we'll soon have to say thank you for your time in office to you and bid you farewell when a new president will take over the leadership of this law school. There will be a special, or probably several special celebrations of that. So today, just a thank you very much for your continued support of the MLB program from everybody in the room. Now, I'm sure that everybody, in particular all the students, but also all the teaching staff, would like to join me in thanking the fantastic MLB program team for their hard work and dedication. Firstly, I should mention Professor Larsen again, the founding dean, for the inspiration and nurture that he has given to the program, which brings it to us today. I would like to thank Professor Günther and Professor Jungmann for their leadership and strategic direction as the program directors. And last, but by no means least, the absolutely wonderful team in the office here, Betty Tönnies, Jenny Gay, Magdalena Kalai, and Maite Schäfer. I know that Kilmeet had called them up here, so therefore. Moving on. Finally, I wanted to thank all the enablers in the room. That is the parents, the spouses, family, and friends who have nurtured your academic interests, who have made and strengthened in you that conviction that education is the key to success. Without your love and support, family, friends, spouses, children, etc., parents most notably, this journey would not have been possible. Now, graduates of the class 2023, give a round of applause to your parents, friends, and family. The final prize that it is my pleasure to announce tonight is the DAAD Prize for Outstanding Achievement of an International Student Studying at a German University. It's a mouthful, isn't it? In the German version, that would be one word. No, it's not. The criteria of the DAAD Prize, in addition to performance on the program, are to reward a student's outstanding contribution to social, cross-cultural, or community engagement. This year's recipient not only has one of the strongest academic profiles of this cohort, but she also has represented Bucerius Law School, and thereby the German education system, internationally at the Law Without Walls competition in St. Gallen in Switzerland. She has displayed an exemplary dedication to her studies and to being an ambassador for the program and the sector more widely. At Bucerius, she was one of the class representatives of the MLB program. Now it should be clear who I'm talking about. She's also been an active participant in a larger group of MLB students who volunteered at the 2023 Special Olympics World Games in Berlin and has previously volunteered as a Spanish teacher at IESEC in Brazil. It is my honor and indeed pleasure to award the DAAD Prize for Outstanding Achievement of International Students Studying at a German University to Laura Streubel. The next prize will be awarded by Magdalena Göbel as a representative of the Bucerius Alumni Association. And before I hand over to Magdalena, I would like to thank the Alumni Association for their support of the MLB program, in particular also during our recent alumni weekend. Many thanks, Magdalena. Over to you, please.
So I'm having trouble of unlocking my iPad. It can only be a couple of seconds. I apologize for that. So I moved from paper to the iPad because I felt like we were in 2023 and that would be the better option, but I guess sometimes it would be better to have paper. But now I figured it out, so thank you for waiting. And first of all, welcome class of 2024, but most importantly, welcome and dear class of 2023. It is an absolute pleasure for me to stand here today, and I would like to extend my heartfelt congratulations to you for being here and for having accomplished the MLB program. Throughout your time here, you have been exposed to a rigorous curriculum. You have been challenged to think critically, to analyze complex issues, and to develop innovative solutions. After all that, you have already established and achieved in your careers, you fought your way through another round of challenges, and you have made it, and we celebrate you today for now receiving or having received the degree of the MLB program and a degree from Germany's leading law school. We hope you are proud of yourselves. We, from the Alumni Association, certainly are. Hopefully, your year here with us also gave you the chance to delve a little bit into German culture and the city of Hamburg, obviously, especially. And most importantly, it hopefully gave you the chance to to connect with other minds from all over the world, to create new friendships and form lasting bonds that will stay with you throughout your personal lives and your careers. Whatever the future may hold for you, I hope and I wish that you stay in touch with each other, but obviously also with our law school. And a great tool for staying in touch, and this is where the advertisement starts, is the Bucerius Alumni Association. We are a vibrant community of alumni. We represent the vast majority of this law school's graduates, and we provide ample opportunities for you to stay in touch and be at social and also professional events. One of them you might have heard about is our career fair on 11 October, and we also host an annual black tie dinner that this year is on 4th November. So I highly recommend it, and I hope to see you there. After the ceremony, colleagues from the association and myself will be downstairs. So if you have any questions, you're welcome to come by, and we're happy to answer them. And we also have a small graduation gift for you, so hope to see you there. But now, apart from congratulating you, as Professor Brisping has announced, I have the special honor to also award the next prize. A little over a year ago, a fellow MLB graduate, Axel Meller, came to us and wanted to create a new award. And I might add, he also substantially funded it. So now, for the second year now, we have the MLB Alumni Award for the Best Master Thesis. And apart from recognition of the quality of the thesis, this award is also endowed with 500 euros. This year's award is a testament to the exceptional quality of research, dedication, and intellectual prowess of this year's candidate and winner. And before you doubt the merits of what I'm saying here, this is of course not my assessment, and I did not choose the winner, but this assessment stems from the two professors and their votes and their extremely good grades of 1.3 and 1.0 that this thesis received. And I might add that these professors rarely give out such good grades, so it is a special honor indeed. As such, it is my absolute pleasure to award the MLB Alumni Awards 2023 to Shubham Joshi. For his thesis, analyzing India's efforts to enforce contracts, re-evaluating the effectiveness of commercial courts. Congratulations again. With that, I will leave you. I hope you enjoyed your time here at Bucerius. I wish you all the best for your future endeavors, and I hope to see you at one of our future events. Thank you.
Now, as you've just heard, this prize was made possible by the generosity of one of our alumni, Dr. Axel Möller, a couple of years ago. And last year, the graduation, the then commemorative speaker, sorry, I can't get my words out, Nata Ghebreyesus, she also wanted to pick up this idea, and she donated an amount of money for a social project. And the Alumni Association has very generously increased the prize money for this prize. But we are trying in general to raise some money for Deutschlandstipendien. And the beauty of Deutschlandstipendien is whatever is given is doubled by the German government, so the taxpayer pays. And those Deutschlandstipendien are used to support a student with their living expenses, or somebody who couldn't afford to take part in the program without that. To this end, we are very modern this year, on the back of your programs a QR code, and if you scan that, that will take you to a PayPal gifting page, and we'd be very grateful, and the students in the future will be very grateful indeed for any donation received. With this, now, you might get an opportunity to do a first scan of that code while you listen to the delights of the musical interlude granted by some students, if you want to come down now, from the graduating class. And we have Yael, Hoa, Leonid, Nolasco, Sherry Kao, Masha Stolbova, and Orhun Ugur with their own performance. After that, while they get themselves ready, there will be a little surprise performance, which is not mentioned on the program, but I'll be back to you with that in a minute. First, over to you.
So while my colleagues are preparing, we're gonna sing two songs. The first song is Forever Young. If you know the lyrics, then just sing along. And the other song is a little bit newer. It's from One Republic, Good Life, and we want to wish the graduating class and also the incoming class and also the rest of the people in the room a good life.
So many dreams fading out of the blue. in a city near Piccadilly. Don't really know how I got here. I got some pictures on my phone, new names and numbers that I don't know. Address to place six that you can stick fixed for tonight. Night turns to whatever we want. We're young enough to say, oh, this is gonna be good life. This is gonna be good life. This could really be good life, good life. Say, oh, got this feeling that you can't find. Like this city is on fire. Like this is gonna be a good life, a good, good life. To my friends in Kiev, I say hello. Friends in New York, they don't know. Paris to China, to Colorado. Sometimes the airplane won't. Sometimes we all got stories, but please tell me what there's to complain about. Let me take you home.
Students never fail to impress me. And to those of you who didn't like it, group work is always worthwhile. That was a proper group effort, fantastic. And to the new class, get used to doing a lot of group work. And if you do, it will pay off. Now, we've got a little extra surprise. We've got with us a friend of the MLB program, and in particular, a personal friend of some participants of this graduating class, and somebody who had hoped to become a member of the MLB program, but who, due to the vagaries of German bureaucracy, ended up nearer the French border rather than the Danish border. So, it is my pleasure to welcome, as a friend of the program, Saptarko Biswas from India with us, and he'll be singing Nell from Gabriel Fauré.
Yeah, hi everyone. I'm here as Vivekanand's friend who is graduating this year, so congratulations to him.
Patroclès soleil, rejoignit ta selle enivrée, penche aussi vers moi ta coupe adorée, mon cadavre est paré. Sous les mots l'abris de la feuille brisée, monte sous pied des voluptés, plus de la mienne, chantons bois écartés. Son ciel enflammé, étoile de la nuit poursive, mais combien plus douce est la clarté vive qui rayonne au mon cœur charmé. La chantante me le long de rivage, terre sous murmure éternel. Avocat mon cœur, cher amour honnel, ne fleurisse plus ton image, ne fleurisse plus ton image.
Thank you, Saptarko. If you ever want to join us, you know who to call. This hopefully has given us an opportunity to recover from the verbosity of the first half of the program, but now to a few more words, and may I now welcome the two class representatives, Sophia Rosenhöfer and Laura Streubel, to address you.
Dear class of 2023, esteemed faculty, administrative staff, families, friends, and to our soon-to-be successors, class of 2024. To borrow a metaphor, our year has been much like a sand clock. Imagine grains of sand from all over the world tumbling down in unison, brushing against one another, blending, sometimes in heated debates. For instance, about the highly contested German origins of the Döner kebab. And now that the year's up, those grains disperse back into the world, taking them with them experiences, learnings, and memories, never to be the same again. This year was marked by the boom of ChatGPT and other generative AI tools. These innovations are shaping a world where interdisciplinary skills are vital. Lucky for us, our curriculum equipped us with the acumen to thrive in a rapidly evolving landscape. It's for us to carry that knowledge, expand on it, and honor the legacy Bucerius has lent us. But let's rewind and touch upon our journey here in Germany. We arrived with our preconceived notions, expecting terrain to follow gravity, and punctuality to be a national pastime. Yet, Hamburg's rebellious reign showed us that here, gravity might be occasionally ignored, and rain comes from any direction except from above. And as for punctuality, well, a few train rides with Deutsche Bahn were enough to remind us that stereotypes often miss their mark and that Verspätung can be an integral part of a culture. Speaking of culture, the warmth and soul of every corner of the world was a defining component of this year. Turkish, Indian, Balkanic, and Georgian meals marveled our taste and minds. Moreover, eye-opening country presentations and anecdotes in class or with a glass in the hand showed us time and time again, cultures are so different and yet we are also deeply similar. Thanks to everyone for sharing their food, costumes, knowledge, and learnings in a melting pot of magic that we will cherish forever. We Latinos gave our bit too. The now patented concept of Latino time, in which strict punctuality gave way to healthy casualness, became a breath of fresh air for all of us. And then there is Javi, whose unwavering enthusiasm, always celebrating birthdays with a candle and cake, made every one of us feel cared for. We also took advantage of the wonders of Europe at the doorstep, some by accumulating a mind-blowing number of train and airplane miles, and others more friendly to Mother Nature by casually biking to Zurich and back. Our friend Vivek, the unofficial videographer of our class, you can see him, ensured we had every memorable moment and party captured. For your information, this speech will be followed by a brief 12-hour presentation of his best shot. To our professors and administrative staff, you built the narrow neck of this sand clock. You channeled our energies, dreams, and ambitions. Thanks to you, we've reached the other side. To our family and friends, thank you for being on both sides, pushing us to begin this journey and proudly waiting for us at the end. To Yevhenia, Masha, Roman, Vitaly, and Andriana, may peace arise and endure in your beloved Ukraine. We stand with you forever. And lastly, to the promising class of 2024, here's a message for you. Each grain in a sand clock leaves its mark. Make your mark. Celebrate diversity, challenge stereotypes, embrace unexpected, and when in doubt, remember, sometimes rain doesn't follow gravity, and that's okay. Congratulations, class of 2023, to new beginnings and to a world that opens up for us to remember this year at the neck of the sand clock. Cheers to us.
We came here from all around the world to learn, to work hard, to enjoy, to fall, and to stand up. I know that for many of you, being abroad has not been easy. Coping with German bureaucracy or the Hamburg winter, or as you can see, even the Hamburg summer, has indeed been challenging. But it was one of the best years of our lives. This year has been full of great memories, extraordinary people, and most importantly, full of learning and growing. To the class of 2023, today I want each one of us to look back to the moment we decided to take this big adventure, the moment we decided to leave our comfort zone and jump into the deep end of uncertainty, the moment we decided to surpass ourselves and achieve something great. I would say we can be very proud of ourselves. To the class of 2024, I can promise that this program is a truly life-changing experience. Enjoy and celebrate the journey. You will have a steep learning curve ahead of you. You will encounter challenges and tremendous opportunities. And let me tell you, you won't find friends here. You will find family. I also still remember how Professor Bisping told us in the introduction week last year, besides the friends you will make here, some of you might even be lucky enough to find their partners for life. Professor Bisping, I agree. Most importantly, let's not forget to thank the people that made all of this happen and supported us on our journey. Thank you to the staff of the MLB for making our year extraordinary. Thank you to the professors for teaching us a lot of content and showing us the limits of brain capacity. Thank you to our families for the ongoing support and most importantly, supporting us and standing us in every situation, especially the stressful and the hard ones. And thank you to everyone from this master for making this year one of the best of our lives. Before I finish my speech, I want to hold on to a tradition. As some of you might remember, I always started off or finished a presentation by reading out a quote. I want everyone in this room, especially on days where we are afraid, where we lack energy, or where we feel stuck, to remember the following words said by Barack Obama. We did not come to fear the future. We came here to shape it together. Thank you. Once again, we wanted to take the time to thank especially the MLB program. So a very warm thank you to Betty, to Magdalena, to Maite, and to Jenny. Thank you very much for the ongoing support, for crying with us over visa issues, and for helping us in every life situation and every moment of our journey. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. And now, what has already been alluded to the video by Vivekanand Bhardwaj, and enjoy.
Stop fucking filming people.
Stop filming those videos, okay?
You ready? Okay, I think we've nearly done it. And with all these wonderful pictures and words in mind, I think we all have a very good feeling to enroll the new class of 2024 to the MLB program. And as before, I hope I sort of do my very best with the names, which are all new to us, and up from so many different countries. So we start with Salvador Carvalho from Portugal. Gabriel Casati Nunez from the Dominican Republic. Crisia Coelho from Brazil. Marta Delgadillo from Nicaragua. Mustafa Demir from Turkey. Jose Antonio Diaz from Peru. Laura Catalina Diaz from Colombia. Ana Fonseca from Brazil. Monica Higuera from Colombia. From Nigeria, Obomato Horsfall. Majube Kamalian from Iran. Priscilla Majite from Ghana. Juan Pablo Malaver from Colombia. Gabriela Morote from Peru. Tobias Pein from Germany. Alexandra Salcedo from Peru. Tamar Samushia from Georgia. Pia Schröder from Germany. Shide Sharif Sadeh from Iran. Bennett Stefan from Germany. Juan Felipe Traber from Colombia. Berkay Dogo Yilmaz from Turkey. And unfortunately, we have quite a number of our new students who are still waiting for their visas because we have the impression that the German embassy have made life much more difficult in some countries and take a long time to proceed visas, even if people apply very early. That's a big shame. We hope that will change, but I hope maybe they're listening to us, they're following us online, and I'm reading out their names. There's Suhal Ahmadzai from Afghanistan, Nevin, yes, Nevin Ece Akay from Turkey, Akaya from Turkey, Janberg Bilir from Turkey, Kardelen Çakir from Turkey, George Nalapat from India, Mikula Oleksin from Ukraine, Meenakshi Sukesh Panakal from India, and Berin Tan from Turkey. So we hope they can join us soon and in the meantime follow us in hybrid lectures online, which works very well. So they should not miss out on the important stuff. Okay, so I think we've done it. I really hope you had a wonderful graduation and welcoming ceremony. I really enjoyed it. I think you're a wonderful graduating class and we are very hopeful and excited about you being here. Now there's downstairs, there will be some food and some drinks so you can mingle, you can talk and you can celebrate your graduates. And last but not least, I would also like to say thank you to the team, also to our technicians, audio technicians in the background, to the photographers who will provide you with wonderful memories of this evening. And I would like to say a special thank to Maite Schäfer. I used her wrong name the other day, her birth name. Maite Schäfer, who's organized this ceremony, who's very detailed, gives me all the right names and makes everything possible. So thank you very much, Maite, and the whole team, and have a wonderful evening.